The orders of the court are: 1, leave to appeal is granted with respect to ground 1 only, and the appeal is dismissed. I will now read a summary. By a majority of 2-1, the Court of Appeal has dismissed Cardinal George Pell's appeal against his conviction for the commission of sexual offences. He will continue to serve his sentence of 6 years imprisonment. He will remain eligible to apply for parole after he has served 3 years and 8 months of his sentence. Whether Cardinal Pell will be released on parole will be a matter for the Adult Parole Board, not the courts. Before describing in summary form why the court has reached the decision it has, there is some relevant context of note. Last year, Cardinal Pell was convicted of 5 specific sexual offences alleged to have been committed on 2 occasions in the mid-1990s when he was the Catholic Archbishop of Melbourne. In a previous trial on the same charges, the jury were unable to reach a verdict. Cardinal Pell's position is that he should not have been convicted. Cardinal Pell's conviction and this appeal have attracted widespread attention, both in Australia and beyond. He is a senior figure in the Catholic Church and is internationally well known. As the trial judge, Chief Judge Kidd, commented when sentencing Cardinal Pell, there has been vigorous and sometimes emotional criticism of the Cardinal, and he has been publicly vilified in some sections of the community. There has also been strong support for the Cardinal by others. Indeed, it's fair to say that this case has divided the community. It is important to stress at the outset that Cardinal Pell's conviction only concerns the 5 offences alleged to have been committed by him. Again, as the trial judge observed, he is not to be made a scapegoat for any perceived failings of the Catholic Church, nor for any failure in relation to child sexual abuse by other clergy. His conviction and sentence could not be a vindication of the trauma by other victims of sexual abuse. The offences in respect of which Cardinal Pell was found guilty by a county court jury were 1 charge of sexual penetration of a child under 16 and 4 charges of indecent act with a child under 16. The trial lasted for 5 weeks. The jury deliberated for several days. The jury's verdict was unanimous. Each of us has watched recordings of the evidence given by 12 of the 24 witnesses at the trial. We have also watched recordings of the view the jury were taken on, the walkthrough.
Well, clearly technical issues there.
Yes, which is a pity, but we do know now what the result is.
Absolutely. The court has decided by a 2-1 majority to dismiss George Pell's application for his appeal, which means he's lost. He gets to stay in prison now, as the Chief Justice Anne Ferguson pointed out, to continue his 6 years imprisonment. Mm-hmm. Until he's eligible for parole, that's not until near the end of 2022. This is a major blow for George Pell and his supporters. They had their hopes pinned on the finding that the jury couldn't have found him guilty. That was their biggest hope, that the Court of Appeal would find that the jury could not have found beyond reasonable doubt that he did molest those 2 schoolboys back in the 1990s. And yet, as you can see now, there are lots of people there who are outside the court who are waiting for this decision. Those are representatives of survivors and survivors groups. Christina Hearn, you're there now. What reaction are you getting?
Well, Brett, there was a big cheer that went up here outside the Supreme Court when news filtered through that appeal had been dismissed. I'm here with Michael. You're a very well-known survivor advocate. Michael, what is the feeling now that you know that George Pell is going back behind bars to serve out the rest of his sentence?
Oh, look, it's absolutely outstanding news. So we can now officially say bar a High Court appeal, and no doubt Pell, he's a master at using every legal tactic there is, but we can now comfortably say Pell is a criminal, Pell is a pedophile, Pell is a destroyer and a maimer of young children. He's a pathetic human being, a pig of a man, and we are elated. Look, 3 years and 8 months we can live with. That's his non-parole period. I'd also like to say I think it's outrageous that he's been able to receive fan mail of up to 2,000 letters while he's there. Prison isn't a retreat. Prison isn't a holiday. Prison isn't a process where, you respond to your fan mail.
Michael, can I just ask, were you anxious today? Because obviously there was the possibility that George Pell could be walking free today. Describe what it's been like for you and others. The advocates today and the relief that you now feel?
Look, it's been truly a nightmare. I had a victim on the phone to me last night at 7:40, just in tears, couldn't talk for the first 5 minutes. Our relief is phenomenal. I must proudly say I did predict this, that it would be overturned, and everyone or most other people said no. And the reason being is, it all came down to this. Beyond reasonable doubt, and were the jury over-emotional about it, at the end of the day, the weakness supposedly was whether the jury had attended the two scenes of the crime. They had. They saw that there was an opportunity. It was beyond reasonable doubt. They've called it right. God bless the 12 good people of Australia.
Thanks very much for joining us, Michael. We know that you are very relieved and we do appreciate your time here. We'll just give you a look around because obviously there's some more cheers that are going up here outside the Supreme Court now that the decision has been made, that the appeal is dismissed and the Cardinal will remain behind bars. Of course, he was sentenced to a maximum of 6 years in prison. As Michael just mentioned there, it's a non-parole period of 3 years and 8 months. So just after that decision was made and news filtered through here, there certainly was a cheer and there is celebrations that are continuing here outside the Supreme Court with survivor advocates after the Court of Appeal handed down their judgment just a short time ago. Bretton Hitch.
Thank you, Christine. And we have rectified now, we seem to have anyway, some of the audio issues we had before. Shall we go back inside the appeal court to hear more of the verdict?
Where the unreasonableness ground is relied upon, the task for the appeal court is to decide whether, on the whole of the evidence, it was open to the jury to be satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that the accused was guilty. The inquiry which this ground requires is a purely factual one, rather than a discrete question of law where the argument is that the trial judge has made an error. When the unreasonableness ground is relied upon, the appeal court reviews the evidence as it was presented to the jury. The appeal court asks itself whether on that factual material it was reasonably open to the jury to convict the accused. Having reviewed the whole of the evidence, two of the judges of the Court of Appeal, Justice Maxwell, President of the Court of Appeal, and I, have decided that it was open to the jury to be satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that Cardinal Pell was guilty of the offences charged. In other words, we decided that there was nothing about the complainant's evidence or about the opportunity evidence which meant that the jury must have had a doubt about the truth of the complainant's account. In our written reasons, we have stated that it is not enough that one or more jurors might have had a doubt. Rather, the jury must have had a doubt. We also state that we did not experience a doubt. Justice Maxwell and I accepted the prosecution's submission that the complainant was a very compelling witness, was clearly not a liar, was not a fantasist and was a witness of truth. In our written reasons, we state, throughout his evidence, the complainant came across as someone who was telling the truth. He did not seek to embellish his evidence or tailor it in a manner favourable to the prosecution. As might have been expected, there were some things that he could remember and many things which he could not. And his explanations of why that was so had the ring of truth. We examined the evidence of other witnesses relevant to the issue of whether there was a realistic opportunity for the offending to have occurred. Was there a reason to doubt the complainant's account? Having read and in some cases watched the evidence of all of the opportunity witnesses, we accepted that there was general consistency and substantial mutual support in the picture they painted of what occurred at the cathedral before, during and after Sunday Mass in the period when Cardinal Pell was Archbishop. Justice Maxwell and I take the view that this was unsurprising, since a defining feature of religious observance is adherence to ritual and compliance with established practice. Justice Maxwell and I state that, at the same time, the evidence of the opportunity witnesses varied in quality and consistency and in the degree of recall, both as between witnesses and within the evidence of individual witnesses. We cite at least two possible explanations for this. First, the passage of 22 years between the alleged events and the trial meant that there was, inescapably, a real degree of uncertainty attaching to the memories of the opportunity witnesses. Secondly, attempting to recall particular events is all the more difficult when the events being described are, as they were here, of a kind which was repeated week after week, year after year, and involved the same participants in the same setting, performing the same rituals and following the same routines. Part of Cardinal Pell's case on the appeal was that there were 13 solid obstacles in the path of a conviction. Justice Maxwell and I have rejected all 13. By way of example, one of the 13 obstacles was said to be that the acts alleged to have been committed by Cardinal Pell in the first incident were physically impossible. The defence relied on categorical statements by Monsignor Portelli, the Prefect of Ceremonies to Cardinal Pell, and by Mr. Potter, the sacristan, that it was not possible to pull the Cardinal's robes to the side. The robes were an exhibit at the trial and had been available to the jury in the jury room during their deliberation. Having taken the advantage of the opportunity to feel the weight of the robes and assess their manoeuvrability as garments, Justice Maxwell and I decided that it was well open to the jury to reject the contention of physical impossibility. The robes were not so heavy nor so immovable as the evidence of Monsignor Portelli and Mr. Potter had suggested. We found that the robes were capable of being manoeuvred in a way that might be described as being moved or pulled to one side or pulled apart. We note that Cardinal Pell did not have to prove anything in the trial. Rather, at all stages of the trial, the burden of proof rested with the prosecution. It was a matter for the prosecution to prove beyond reasonable doubt that there was a realistic opportunity for the offending to take place. That involved showing that the offending was not impossible. The prosecution also bore the burden of proving beyond reasonable doubt that the particular sexual acts took place. Justice Maxwell and I observed that while the defence for Cardinal Pell maintained submissions based on impossibility in the appeal, we steadily bore in mind that there was and is no onus whatsoever upon Cardinal Pell to prove impossibility, that is, that it was impossible for the offending to have occurred. In his dissenting judgment, Justice Weinberg found that at times the complainant was inclined to embellish aspects of his account. He concluded that his evidence contained discrepancies, displayed inadequacies, and otherwise lacked probative value, so as to cause him to have a doubt as to the applicant's guilt. He could not exclude, as a reasonable possibility, that some of what the complainant said was concocted, particularly in relation to the second incident. Justice Weinberg found that the complainant's account of the second incident was entirely implausible and quite unconvincing. Nevertheless, Justice Weinberg stated that in relation to the first incident, if the complainant's evidence was the only evidence, he might well have found it difficult to say that the jury, acting reasonably, were bound to have a reasonable doubt about the Cardinal's guilt. He went on to note, however, that there was more than just the complainant's evidence. In Justice Weinberg's view, there was a significant body of cogent and, in some cases, impressive evidence suggesting that the complainant's account was, in a realistic sense, impossible to accept. To his mind, there is a significant possibility that the Cardinal may not have committed the offences. In those circumstances, Justice Weinberg stated that, in his view, the convictions could not stand. Nevertheless, the appeal on the unreasonableness ground has been dismissed because two of us took a different view of the facts. I will now turn to the second and third grounds of appeal. The court has unanimously refused leave to appeal in relation to the second and third grounds, which concerned legal rather than factual issues. Ground two concerned an animation. The animation depicts a blueprint of the cathedral complex with a series of coloured dots and lines shown moving through the complex. Each coloured dot or line is attributed to a particular person or group. For example, the complainant or the choir as a whole when processing out of the cathedral after Sunday Solemn Mass. On the right-hand side of the screen, a window of text is featured. At the top of the window, quotes taken from the transcript of evidence of witnesses favourable to Cardinal Pell's case fade in and out throughout the course of the animation. These quotes are said to accord with the movements of the various dots and lines depicted. At the bottom of the window, quotes taken from the transcript of the complainant's evidence fade in and out, ostensibly to accord with the movement of the dots representing himself and the other boy. The trial judge ruled that the animation could not be shown to the jury as part of the defence final address. We have agreed with the trial judge. The animation bore little resemblance to the actual state of the evidence, but rather presented a distorted picture of that evidence. The animation was tendentious in the extreme. For example, it showed the priest's sacristy with the complainant and the other boy in the room, in company with a large number of concelebrant priests. There was no evidence of any kind that this particular scenario had occurred. It was plainly intended to implant in the minds of the jury that the complainant's account must have been impossible because the evidence showed that there were concelebrant priests in the room at the time of the alleged offending. The visual representation, ostensibly based on the state of the evidence at trial, had the potential of misleading or at least confusing the jury. We have held that the trial judge correctly ruled that the animation should not be used in the way contemplated by Cardinal Pell's lawyers. As noted, ground three concerned whether there was a fundamental irregularity in the trial process. This was said to be on the basis that Cardinal Pell was not arraigned in the presence of the jury panel as required by the Criminal Procedure Act. A person is arraigned when the court asks the accused, in this case Cardinal Pell, if he is the person named on the indictment. Each charge is read out and the accused is asked whether he pleads guilty or not guilty. The question in this case was whether that was done in the presence of the jury panel. The jury panel were in a different room watching by video link when these things were done. We held that the word presence in the context of the legislation includes presence by video link and does not require physical presence. Leave to appeal on this ground was refused. The summary I have just read is necessarily incomplete. It is not intended as a substitute for the court's reasons or to be used in any later consideration of our reasons. The only authoritative pronouncement of the court's reasons and conclusions is that contained in the published reasons for judgment. The summary can now be handed out.
So there we have the verdict, the judgment handed down by the Chief Justice, and this is a story that's making news around the world, as you would expect. It's already on the online edition of the Washington Post, I just noticed, and so it's going to be widely reported, and there'll be lots of talk about this for a long time to come.
Hi YouTubers, I'm Davina Smith. Well, click here to keep watching Great Nine videos and subscribe to our channel here for lots more news, analysis and exclusive content. For breaking news, see you at 9news.com.au.